So Joan, your time has come. My time is shortly to end in a few minutes. Professor Joan Duda is a world-leading expert on motivational process and determinants of adherence and optimal function. She's Professor of Sport and Exercise Psychology in the School of Sport, Exercise and Rehabilitation Sciences at the University of Birmingham. Some metrics about Joan. So Joan has published over 300 peer review articles in international journals and books at an H index of 82. She's attracted over £5 million worth of competitive funding and supervised numerous graduate students. And collectively, that body of work has given rise to an evidence-based training program that operates in a number of countries around the world, particularly through the PAPA project that's called Empowering Coaching. In academic circles, if you mention the term sports psychology, we instantly think of the name Duda. Joan, I've really enjoyed working with you so far, and I'm extremely excited about having you here as president with your academic standing, and particularly the fact that you'll be the first president from the discipline of sports psychology. We welcome you to the platform for your presidential address.
Thank you. Well, hello, everyone. Thanks very much to my good colleague and dear friend Tim Cable for those kind and gracious words. I really am humbled and honored to have this opportunity to be the incoming president of ECSS. It is a privilege for me. And I think in terms of looking towards the future is very, very bright in terms of what we can achieve. I don't know about you, I imagine it's the same. I've had a fabulous several days here in Essen. The Congress has been fantastic. And I was really struck by the themes that have run through not just our opening ceremony, we'll see in a couple hours if it is also our closing ceremony, but our plenaries as well. And those were those four I's: inclusion, inactivity, individuality, and identification. And I thought it was such a good idea that I was going to pinch it a bit for my presidential address and also have the four I's. Inclusion is in there because inclusion is so important, but we're going to talk about interdisciplinarity in our field and whether we can raise our game, implementation of all the great science we do in this college, and how we can further our impact. So, in this address, and let me just tell you right now, there's no DVD or tutorial or criteria for presidential addresses. So here's what I decided to do. I'm going to speak a little bit about why I'm here in ECSS, why I joined this family, what attracted me, and what are my aspirations for our college as we move forward. Now, I could talk about the kind of the health of the college and the administration of the college, and I'm not going to do that. I mean, I will say we're in a very good place, and we keep getting to be in a better place. Financially, we're stronger than we were before. We still want to increase those reserves, but we're doing better. We're getting a real grip thanks to our college office in Cologne in terms of how to run these congresses, we've moved to that model a couple of years ago. And under the guidance of our president, Tim Cable, we have now our VMOS, our vision, our mission, our KPIs, and so on. And so we're moving forward. But I'd rather talk now a little bit about science and maybe ways we can challenge ourselves within this college to, as I said before, to raise our game. And then, rather than talking CVs and going through specific research and whatever, my thought was, in terms of doing this, you'll know a little bit about me, the work I do, and frankly, what I think and hold most dear about this fantastic field of sports sciences. I've always been a believer in service. Sometimes universities don't recognize that much anymore. I mean, back when I was living on the other side of the pond, I became involved in whether it was AFERD or discipline-specific organizations like NASPA and ASP. Continued to do that when I moved over here to Europe, and also was very much involved with our, I guess, apparent disciplined organizations like the American Psychological Association and the International Association of Applied Psychology, trying to keep the conversation going, to communicate, to inform, to impact. Now, in terms of ECSS, I actually was trying to remember, and I think my first ECSS was in 2003 in the beautiful town of Salzburg. And I really enjoyed it, and that's why I kept coming back. Certainly within those couple days in Salzburg, I was exposed to the latest research in sport and exercise psychology, my discipline. But I also learned something about the latest research, theory, methods, findings in the other social sciences and humanities. We're not all one big pot. There are distinct subdisciplines within that pillar, as well as latest research in the other sports sciences. And if I would be really honest with you, I would say that I learned some things here, but I really learned a lot of interesting information and perspectives by listening to other colleagues in other disciplines speak and share their research. And so then I became involved in ECSS. And I like that term, pay it forward, because in my career, I mean, I will end it very as a happy woman, because the sports science has given me so much, and I want to try my best to give back, especially to this young generation, which I totally agree with what Tim said was exemplified in what we just saw here in the young investigator presentation. So I was invited to be involved in the scientific committee by a very well-respected colleague, Tom Riley. I was on that committee for four or five years. Then Anton Wagenmacher, a good friend and colleague, invited me onto the scientific board. I was there for a year or two, and then it just kept on going, and then I moved on to the executive board, and I've been on that board for now 5 years, and it's been a pleasure and a privilege. So just some comments about why ECSS, though. Why join and why stay in my perspective? Well, at the heart of ECSS is always going to be the science. And I am a scientist, I am a researcher. I ask questions and I like answers. And by my discipline, or where I do my research, happens to be sport and exercise psychology. And as Tim was saying, I study motivation, which to this day, I've been studying for 35 years, and I'm still motivated to study motivation. Still fascinating to understand, you know, what contributes to variations in the quality of motivation, how this relates to engagement in sport, in lifestyle physical activity, in exercise classes, in dance, in physical education, and so on. And in particular, what's the role of the social environment in influencing these motivational processes? And in all the work I do with my team, we very much pull from theory, try to integrate across theoretical frameworks, and the overarching aim is interventions to make a difference. So, it came to ECSS, and lo and behold, there were the three pillars. And so there was one that I fit comfortably within, that last one, social sciences and humanities. And even if I looked at the vision statement, it spoke about being multidisciplined in our perspective on sport and exercise. So it felt comfortable, it felt at home. Another aspect that was attractive to me was just, it's called the European College of Sports Science. Well, what a global reach we have. I think the latest date, if you talk about this particular Congress, 84 countries are represented. That's incredible. And what's interesting, too, is to see the trend. If you look here, in terms of representatives at the congresses that are from the European Union and non-European countries, you can see how it has risen over the years to more than a third of those that are participating in this congress are from countries outside the EU. Now, I live in Europe. I love Europe. I wanted UK to stay in Europe, by the way, but my passport is not European. So I think, if anything, my standing in front of you exemplifies this very exciting trend about ECSS being more and more international. Conclusion. Well, I looked, and we had FAB founding fathers. I couldn't find initially any FAB founding mothers, but we were off to a good start here. But I mean, the issue is ECSS inclusive? And here we're talking in terms of gender. Is it a man's world as well as a woman's world in terms of this particular association? And again, if you look at that data, it's quite interesting. In any particular year, a third to 40% of those that are here representing and being involved in this Congress are women. We're seeing more and more excellent young women as early career researchers, again, I think exemplified today. If we look at how the scientific board and the scientific committee has evolved over the years, more and more women are involved in that as well. And that is a sign, in my view, of a healthy organization. But it's also important to look if there are any glass ceilings in terms of the leadership and with respect to executive boards. And I really acknowledge the women that became before me that are on the board. Here's all the women that have served on the executive board of ECSS. And in particular now, I've had a chance to serve with two outstanding women, Gisela and Bente, over the years. And I say to you with great sincerity, I am very, very proud to be standing here as the first female president of ECSS. Okay, so that's inclusion, and there's more aspects of inclusion, of course, we always have to keep in mind. But let's talk about those other three I's and how they might challenge us in terms of evolving sport and exercise sciences as we move forward. Nice definition of multidisciplinary research and perspectives, talking about how you have to pull from multiple academic disciplines, which we have, to address, to redefine problems outside normal boundaries or disciplinary boundaries, and reach solutions based on a new understanding of complex situations. I think that's what we'd like to aspire to do. But I think I would say that to date, we're not quite there. We're on our way, but we're not quite there. We do have different disciplines, but still, I think we stay a little bit in our silos and we're kind of doing our own thing. We're still a little more additive rather than interactive in our exchanges, rather than trying to make connections. And there's a lot of good intentions. For example, I don't know how many years ago it was instituted that the plenary sessions would have two speakers from two different disciplines. That's great, but do we integrate? Do we pull together what they're trying to say in terms of promoting the field and moving forward? And I think it's this kind of point is reflected in this graphic here. So here, typically, when we look at abstracts, here are the different topics. And then we count up and we give percentages and so on. But it's quite interesting to me, I mean, I look across that array, most, if not all, should be multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary. And so we tend to go and put them in a particular, like in this, you know, physiology and sports medicine and the red and what have you. And I think to some degree that's artificial, and I think in another degree it's holding us back. And let me give you three examples from myself, coming from my particular research. I know out there you can probably give a lot of other examples of just three of those particular topics. Whoops, sorry. There we go. Testing, health and fitness, coaching, right? Labeled as physiology and sports medicine. So again, I'm just illustrating from the work that myself and my team have done. I'm sure you can give a lot of other illustrations of studies that have been done that are from other disciplines that relate to testing. and help us move forward in this particular and important aspect of the sports sciences. Same thing could be said about health and fitness. In fact, that's a growing multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary area in terms of work on behavioral change and so on. It doesn't just slot into one pillar. And the question I guess I'm asking all of us, should it slot into only one pillar? And coaching. I think that's just typically classified under biomechanics. My heavens, there's so much work going on in this college that relate to coaching from different disciplines. So I'd rather see something like this. Unicolor, because let's talk about hot topics, but approaching those topics from different disciplines and hopefully connecting across disciplines in the way we understand them. So, I'm not a fan for counting abstracts and putting them into categories. I think my question to all of us would be, what will make it more likely that sport science research, as we embrace it within our college, makes a difference in this world? How can we move forward? And so we go from multi to interdisciplinary. And there you can see, first word, key aspect of that definition is integrate. Pulling together perspectives, concepts, models, and so on, joining together in trying to further our knowledge. And you know, there was a very interesting paper I came across that was in our European Journal of Sports Science, was published last year, that actually analyzed abstracts with this lens. And yes, they found examples or data that illustrate that there are these three pillars. But when they analyzed keywords and aspects of the abstracts, there were so many connections across different disciplines. All right, so it is happening. We are joining forces in terms of trying to move sports sciences further. And this has always been kind of a passion of mine, and I find it very exciting as a scientist when I get a chance to work with others. And this, now we're going way back. I was about 10 years old, I think, when I published this paper. Some of the early work at that time, a lot of work on physical activity and health, and they were starting to branch it into mental health in terms of understanding psychological stress. There was a lot of work on personality differences and so on that led to whether people had exacerbated responses to psychological stress or not. But we tried to join forces, and by definition, it was an interdisciplinary team of physiologists and health scientists trying to look at the role of physical activity, chronic fitness, as well as acute on these type of responses. Another example, and here combining forces with motor development specialists, neuroscience, and biomechanists, we looked at the question of, again, in sports psychology, my heavens, rich, large literature on arousal and anxiety and performance. In neuroscience, motor control, rich literature on looking at the coordination of movement, spatial temporal aspects of coordination and so on, and how we could perturb it. So we tried to pull it together. We looked at the implications of a social psychological stressor on the kinematics and the kinetics of movement. And we found that it did make a difference. That does perturb the system when there is psychological stress, and the bottom line that the movements became less efficient, kinetic ratio, energy was higher, etc. And even it was nice to go back and read the discussion of that paper, because we pushed in that paper itself to be even broader in our disciplinary reach and bring in colleagues from motor control and also incorporate EMG data in terms of those questions. And the last one is an illustration. This is looking at, in psychology, and particularly in the area of motivation, we do a lot of work based on self-determination theory. And there, a key determinant of people's responses and engagement is the degree to have what they say their psychological needs satisfied. That's as, do they feel competent? Do they feel autonomy? Do they feel connected? And study after study has shown that if you have basic psychological needs satisfaction, you report greater well-being, vitality, etc. Then you had the literature on cortisol and its implications in terms of stress and physical health. So what we did is go out to a real life situation. One of the contexts I do work is in terms of vocational professional dance. And we looked at vocational dancers who have that solo end of the year performance and getting up there and trying to make a difference. And we measured these various variables at different times as they prepared for that solo performance. And bottom line, what did we see? It made sense to connect these areas of research. If those dancers felt that the way the teachers interacted with them made them feel a sense of autonomy, made them feel competent, made them feel connected, so they had this positive psychological need satisfaction, when they came to that very important performance at the end of the year, they looked at it more as a challenge than a threat, and if that happened, their cortisol levels were attenuated. Look at all the other topics we can approach this way. Physical activity and health. I mean, if I think about when I entered the sports sciences 30 years ago, that list now that's demonstrated research of implications for an active lifestyle was a lot shorter. Now we know so much, but then we know the big challenge. People still are not moving or moving at the level that they need to accrue these benefits. And one of the inspiring talks that have been delivered in ECSS that I went back and had a lovely listen to preparing this address was from one of our founding fathers and founding president, I believe, now is Professor Ben Saltain, who spoke to us in Barcelona and actually made the call very loud and clear of how we need to join together to try to promote human health. Actually, a very nice memory for me is my last recall of speaking with Ben was at the airport. And I went up and said how struck I was by his talk. And we ended up chatting about how to pull the disciplines together for about 20 minutes until we both had to board our respective flights. Very special man. Talent identification, development, I think that was nicely, the point was made in Mark Williams' plenary a couple days ago. And, okay, I'm an I word from the group here, inactivity. Ripe for interdisciplinary type of work and connection. And I give you an illustration. So we're looking at four people here, huh? And they all are quite sedentary. 10, 12 hours a day they spend sitting, at the very least. Now, we have this bloke here. He's very high achieving and a bit of a workaholic. So he's there, you know, working intensely at his computer for so many hours a day. Then we have this lady here who, when some of her sedentary behavior resolves around, she loves to read and sitting and enjoying in her leisure time a very good book. Then we have this guy here who's clearly a Liverpool football fan, and he used to play a little bit of footy when he was younger. Those days seem to be gone, but he spends a lot of time sitting and cheering for his favorite football team. And then we have this woman here, and this picture, I give thanks to my good colleague back in Birmingham, Jonas Thompson, who's worked with Bangladeshi women. Now, in that culture, now this woman's about 52 years old. She spends a lot of time sitting. Why? Because that's her reward. That's her reward for raising her kids and now moving on in her life. To sit is the recognition of what she's. So the question is, how in the name of heaven could we ever really understand determinants, implications, and how to change these behaviors if we don't work together? Okay. Very, very important. And so I was thinking about the different plenaries and talks I've had a chance to listen to over the last couple days, and I've even extended, I think, this model that somehow, and this is a tribute to my good colleague Hans Hoppler, in terms of genetics as well, you know, we need to sit down and have that kind of conversation about ways forward and ways to connect in our research. In this case, for example, addressing the large time people spend sedentary in our society. And I think embedded in that is now calling for even us to be transdisciplinary, where we don't just connect now with our own models and what have you at a certain point in the research process. We start in the beginning, in a conversation, an initial model and the initial theoretical framework is interdisciplinary from the start. I find that incredibly exciting, and I think ECSS is a place where something like that could thrive. And we are moving in this direction. In Dublin, for the first time, Dublin 2018, we're going to have at least a pillar for multi and interdisciplinary type of submissions. But it's interesting now, to be honest with you, that came about more for a pragmatic reason, rather than a theoretical, conceptual, embracing, crossing-discipline perspective. And that is, you know, we had our pillars, we had our silos. Heavens, what happens when someone submitted an invited symposium and it had people from the different disciplines? Where would they go? What slot would we put them in? People were very concerned with numbers. But at least now we do have that fourth pillar, and I think that's very exciting. I just put here some thoughts about, as we build that pillar, what to keep in mind. And that is, to me, I look at this as we share a common culture, a culture that is based on respect and the belief that only with making these connections we're going to move sports science forward. You need to have a curiosity for disciplines other than one's own. And I also think you need to be confident. You need to be confident that your discipline is great, and it's cool, and it's fantastic, and you love it, but you know what? None of us and none of our disciplines have all the answers. So you have to be secure in that point that we need to work together to advance the field. A couple more eyes very quickly. Implementation. What is that? That's the process of putting a plan, in our case primarily research findings, into effect. And it's a systematic application of research findings into practice. Research to practice. And in a sense, implementation is really a journey. Now, if I think about the work that we do in this college, there's some of us who stay in one of these circles. There's some of us who try to make the progress. I mean, I would say, in my view, none of those circles is more important than the other. But as a field, we need to make that journey, because that's the only way we're going to be able to implement and have an effect on this larger world of ours. And we, you know, in the work that we do on motivation, we try our best. We usually work in the lab, test our theories, go out, feasibility, some cross-sectional longitudinal studies, and then we move on and try and test and tailor our interventions. We haven't mastered it yet, but that's the spirit of what we try to do. And all the projects, they tend to be interdisciplinary in the type of outcomes and processes that we measure. So I think this is along with another, aligned with another important aspect of that vision, and that is application. We're not just about creating science, we're about getting the word out and applying it to the larger world. My last I, and that's impact. So we go out in the real world, we're testing, we're trying to implement, and now we want a marked effect or influence on our relevant world. And what does this mean? We want to impact guidelines. We want to impact standards of practice, whether that's of coaches, whether that's of teachers, whether that's of GPs, physiotherapists. And we want to inform and guide policy. And in our work, we try to do that. And actually, the way we try to achieve that is involving our stakeholders right from the beginning, right at the beginning of that journey. And we travel with them all the way through. And when you do that, not easy, but easier to try to implement and change and create something that is a lasting impact. So my question is, in a college level, what can we do in that regard raises the stakes? I'm not asking to change the vision statement, but I think this is at my heart, and hopefully the hearts of all or many of you as you read that vision statement, in terms of what we're all about. So we've had several days of very provocative and very productive e-board meetings. And many of what points that we discussed, I think, are aligned with what I'm talking about. We need to keep further inclusion. We need to make sure that young scientists, we empower them into the organization and they see a pathway that they can have an input and have an impact. We need more interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary work, and we're talking about tweaking, not changing completely, the plenaries in ways that maybe it can be, the exchange is more interdisciplinary at the end. That new pillar, to make sure it's not just multidisciplinary, submission of three silo papers, but we try to push it a bit so there is that type of connections. Workshop, brainstorms with the incredible minds that we have in this room in terms of how to be transdisciplinary, in terms of the major issues that face us as a society that our college has much to say about. And by definition, when you're transdisciplinary, you do need the social sciences and humanities. And we've been working very hard to connect with other organizations like FEPSAC so that we ensure the presence of those folks when it's money is limited, and we have choices to make, that they come and they stay within our college. And lastly, about facilitating implementation and impact. Why don't we do more in terms of involving stakeholders and policymakers in our discussions? Why are they not here helping us listen to what we say and saying what else do they need? What else can they use information to implement change? Because once again, if we only go so far with implementing and we don't have long-standing impact, all that our field can achieve is going to be much less than is possible. A couple last points, and then I'll say my goodbyes. It's been fantastic on the executive board to date, and I look forward to the years to come. I've had the pleasure of working with two presidents before my predecessor, Professor Michael Norisi and Sigmund Lowlin. I learned so much from them. But let me say some words about my predecessor, Professor Tim Cable, who I call a dear friend. Wow. You've lived in the college in a great place. I have so much admiration for the energy, for the passion and commitment that you have given ECSS. I'm not saying that those are your shoes. I like the picture. But we are inclusive. They could be your shoes, and that's all right, okay? I hope that passion and commitment continues in the years as we move forward. And we've heard, I learned now, the Dortmund group likes to sing this song, and Liverpool likes to sing it. I approach this position with that spirit. Please, I don't want to be alone. We need the family. We need the collectivity. We need the village, as a famous female politician from the States once said. So fantastic executive board. A lot of the things that we talked about, we're already discussing, and hopefully we can continue that exchange. The ECS office, what would we do without you guys? You're fab. I love that picture. In terms of helping us busy, crazy academics, sometimes disorganized, who volunteer for what we do, help keeping us moving the college forward. And of course, we are about science and our scientific board and scientific committee and our new panel of reviewers, which is very exciting. So in closing, thank all of you. I look forward to exchanging with you, hearing from you, working for you, and trying to address some of these challenges as we move forward over the next 2 years. Thank you.